Right now we're looking at self-healing materials, and these are materials that when they get damaged, they heal themselves, and they do it in an autonomic fashion. So there's no human intervention, it happens automatically.
A lot of schemes, say, for repair of materials involve heating them or welding them back together, but that all requires that you find the crack and you intervene. So our systems are really much like a passive biological system. It's just waiting for a stimulus, and it can heal without you ever really knowing that it healed.
I think the unique thing is really the idea that materials without any electronic external kinds of feedback mechanisms are simply using environmental factors to undergo a change, and it doesn't require anything except whatever you've integrated into the material system itself.
We started with microcapsules that we formulate and fabricate in the lab, and then we integrate those into new material systems.
They are solid-like, but if you squeeze them between two slides, then you can see that there's a reasonable quantity of liquid that is present in that what appears to be a solid material. If those capsules are in a composite material that's damaged by a crack, the liquid contents that are in those capsules can wick into the crack plane, and that is what will eventually form a solid polymer that will rebond the interfaces of that crack back together.
They can go in ductile polymers, they can go in brittle polymers, they can go in advanced composite structures, adhesives, paints, so they're kind of ubiquitous.
It might be a prosthetic device that lasts longer and doesn't require an invasive surgery, or it may simply be that we are making a contribution to the environment because goods are more durable.
I think very soon you'll see self-healing paints and coatings. And these are coatings that you would put on a metal as something that you'd like to protect, because if you don't, it's going to rust when it's being exposed to harsh environments. And these kinds of coatings will heal themselves when they've got scratch damage and then protect the substrate. And the end result is a much longer lifetime for whatever you've put the paint onto. We've started to translate the same concepts that we looked at in terms of structural failure and restoration into things like batteries that will self-heal now by restoration of simple electrical connectivity.
We've put things like liquid gallium or encapsulating carbon nanotubes and nanoparticles of silver, all for their conductive restoration properties. And then second, we're working on ways of shutting the battery down when it does get out of control and it gets too hot.
If a battery pack in a vehicle gets out of control, it's going to be a pretty catastrophic event. And so trying to make sure we have mechanisms in place to automatically trigger the shutdown of a battery pack if it's going into a runaway situation is really important.
Storage becomes a critical issue in the success of renewable resources. You've got to be able to store and deliver in a regular way so that you can run businesses, factories, meet all the energy demands if you want them to really be effective. And that's where batteries come into play.
And as an engineer, I mean, there's nothing better than seeing your work being applied and commercially relevant to industry. And to see the link from the basic science going all the way through that entire spectrum to really applied work happening simultaneously with students side by side is really fundamentally exciting. We had worked outside of the Beckman for probably 3 years and had struggled mightily to try to make advances in the whole area of self-healing. When we moved to Beckman, it was like putting us on an accelerator, on a roller coaster ride. It really took off.
This is an environment that is incredibly stimulating from always being challenged with what are problems that need addressing, and then finding people who are here and interested in those problems to work alongside.
And without the Beckman, I don't think it would have happened. So that's how critical I think it has been to my own research career and advancing the kinds of things that we've done.